all of you are career leaders. Your careers have transitioned. Your life has transitioned. And we live in interesting times. You know, 377, Adultery Act. Obviously, Me Too. I think there's a lot going on in context of women. I think for the first time, mainstream media and our conversations are getting so much of attention. You know, but from your individual perspectives, take us through how has this gender lens changed over a period of time, like. As women leaders, as change makers in your own field, you know, not necessarily just gender change makers, as change makers, how do you feel about standing where we are today? You know, going back to what Renu said, you know, it's her daughter. How do you feel as a change maker standing where we stand today? And what's your hope from tomorrow? I think she will go with you first.
I think one of the things that over the years, as I've seen more of this country, more of this city, I think one of the things that, as I was saying earlier, I've realized is how privileged we are. I think what would have bothered me as a woman growing up in this city was the fact that maybe I couldn't step out of my home that easily after 8 p.m. in the evening. The fact that, as was mentioned earlier, my father would probably have to pick me up from different places where I would have to go for extracurricular activities after school. But I think that the more you interact with the real world, the more you realize that these are, it's almost like these are first world problems. And I've been working with Delhi government schools now for more than 3 years. And the kind of situations that a lot of the young girls in this city encounter, and therefore I'm sure a lot of young girls across the country encounter. One day I was in a government school, and anyone who sends their children now to government schools usually does it out of no other choice, because they feel that they can't afford a good private school education. And I was speaking to some of the girls in the school, and this is a school assembly, and I asked some of them that how many of you have brothers who study in private schools? And I think there would have been about 400 girls in the school assembly, and more than 350 of them raised their hands and said, my brother study in a private school. And so these are girls whom the parents have already decided that they have no future. They've already decided that they can send their children, their daughters, to places where education doesn't really matter. And another instance happened when there's a lot of problem in our education system. There's something called the no detention policy, where students keep passing year on year till they reach class 9. And so in class 9 in schools all over the country, you have a lot of children who fail their exams. And last year, some girls came to meet us who had failed the class 9 exam twice or thrice. And they said, ki ma'am, humare liye koi nayi policy leke aa jaiye jisse hum phir se school mein admission le sakte hain. Agar hame school mein admission nahi milega to hamare mata pita hamari shaadi kar denge. And these are girls who are studying in the national capital. We are not here talking of Bihar, Chhattisgarh, Orissa, that parts of the country that we consider backward. Girls still don't, there are many girls who still work at home. There are many girls who cook food for their family. There are many girls in Delhi who do not go to school because they have to look after their younger siblings. And I think what has really changed for me over the years is an understanding that those of us who can sit in Hayat Regency and have this conversation are probably far, far, far more privileged than we realize, and maybe we need to look around the world a little more.